deep catch, isn't it?
This is where I'm sitting, right?
All right. Well, we're now going to have our final panel, and it is one that I am incredibly excited about. I will set this up by saying that there is a reason that this is the last panel of the entire summit, because we have spent the last, 3 days talking about statistics and talking about data and talking about legislation and court cases and all these very complex things. And they're important. I think everybody in this room understands why these things are important. But at the end of the day, you get away from the policy wonk community and you just start talking to real people, you've got to communicate these ideas through telling stories. It's not just a matter of data and research and numbers. And so we wanted to invite three people who have backgrounds as storytellers. They've all got a background in the film industry, and these are people who are very well qualified to talk about the storytelling aspect of criminal justice. I'm gonna introduce all of them to you right now, and I think we're gonna have a terrific conversation. First of all, to my immediate left here is Scott Budnick. He is the founder and president of the Anti-Recidivism Coalition. Budnick was formerly the executive vice president of Green Hat Films, and he was the executive producer of many successful comedies, including the Hangover series. Budnick currently serves on the board of Inside Out Writers, an organization that aims to reduce juvenile recidivism through the use of creative writing. He also serves on the advisory board for the Loyola Law School Center for Juvenile Law and Policy, and was selected to be a board member of President Obama's newly created foundation, My Brother's Keeper Alliance. For his work with youth in the criminal justice system, Governor Jerry Brown of California named Budnick California's Volunteer of the Year for 2012. We also have Daniel Chalfen. Chalfen is a documentary film and television producer and the co-founder of Naked Edge Films. His documentaries have premiered at the world's foremost film festivals, including Berlin, Cannes, Toronto, and Tribeca. They've opened theatrically and have been broadcast worldwide and have won or been nominated for multiple awards, including DuPonts, Emmys, and Oscars. Chalfen's focus is on character-driven films set to social, political, and legal issues. We also have Scott Christopherson, who's a director, producer, and cinematographer. His most recent film, Peace Officer, a documentary about the increasingly militarized state of American policing, won the Grand Jury and Audience Awards at the 2015 South by Southwest Film Festival. Christopherson previously worked as the documentary arts director for Spy Hop Productions and led the Sundance Institute's youth documentary workshops. He received his MFA in documentary cinema from San Francisco State University and a Master of Arts in Anthropology from the University of Wisconsin-Madison. He's currently an assistant professor of documentary film at St. Edward's University in Austin, Texas. I am pleased to welcome all three of them to this stage. I want to give all of you a chance to talk about specific film projects that you've been working on. But before I do that, actually, I'm going to ask you a question that kind of came up last night. We had a journalism panel, and one of our journalists made an interesting point. He said, you know, I worry sometimes, I hope I'm characterizing you correctly here, Scott. He said, I worry sometimes that the way journalists write is that they start with a story, and then 4, 5, 6 paragraphs down, they get into the public policy questions. And I think you could make an argument that the storytelling is so dominating the process that it's poisoning getting good policy out there. Do you think there's something to be said for that? Scott, what do you think?
Absolutely. I mean, that couldn't be more accurate. It's all how you frame something. When I produced a movie called Old School, and another producer of mine brought me into juvenile hall and said, come be a guest speaker in my creative writing class. And so I walked into juvenile hall for my first time. Now, if I told you the story, I could tell it in two different ways. One way is I went into juvenile hall and sat down with a bunch of kids who were gang members and convicted of violent crimes, and I sat next to a young, scary-looking Hispanic kid who just got sentenced to 300 years for multiple attempted murders. And that would be one way for me to start off that conversation. Or I could tell you that I walked into juvenile hall and I sat next to David Negrete. And David Negrete had just been sentenced. He was 15 years old, and he had just been sentenced to 300 years in prison for standing next to his friend who shot the victim in the butt. The victim was in and out of the hospital in a day. And for standing next to the guy that shot the victim, David Negrete, at 15 years old, went to prison for 300 years. And that's a true story. And depending on how I tell that story, when I start getting into the policies of, do we really want to charge children as adults? Do we really want to send children into the adult prison system, a system that's going to make them worse? Obviously, the way we frame that issue from a policy perspective is quite important. And with David, we ended up writing a bill because of that sentence, Senate Bill 260, which looked at everyone who committed crimes under the age of 18 and received life sentences in prison. And this bill gave them a chance of a parole hearing after 15, 20, or 25 years. And because we framed it with storytelling, by telling the stories of the kids who were affected by this, not just the worst act of their life, or the police report that documents the worst act of their life, but who they were before, what led up to this, and what they've become since. And now, in California, we passed the bill with a sweeping bipartisan measure. 9 Republicans joined the Democrats, and the governor signed it on day 2. And now David Agretti gets to go to the parole board in 8 years. And that was a bill we passed, but the entire strategy of advocating for this legislation was around storytelling and framing the young people we're talking about. So obviously, it has an absolutely huge effect.
Daniel, look like you want to say something.
Yeah, I think the kind of the benefit of film over print journalism and piracy aside is that to an extent we can control the context in which the audience sees a film. And there's definitely a difference between showing a film on hundreds or thousands of screens that just brings an issue without any context to the policy agenda, but brings it up as an issue to many, many people, or we can take it into a Senate screening or into a very direct screening. And so that control of context, I think, is very important. We just, maybe we'll come back to talking about it, a film that we have out at the moment called The Mind of Mark DeVries, is a criminal justice issued film. It showed on Showtime, it played in theaters across the country, kind of out of context, but at least bringing up the issues of prison and mental illness and parole. But we also could take the film specifically into the parole board in Florida, which ended up partly helping get the prisoner who's the film is about, 70 years shaved off his sentence. We could take it into places where people could very directly, we could contextualize the policy issues involved with the film. So I think the context in which it's shown is something we can control is very beneficial. Mm.
Scott, what do you think?
Yeah, I kind of like to call documentary films, well, some documentary films, slow journalism, right?
Yeah.
You really get to take your time with individuals or characters, and like, for instance, in our film, we follow a former sheriff, his name's Dub Lawrence, who started the SWAT team in his county in Utah, the first SWAT team there in the 1970s, and then that same SWAT team ended up killing his son-in-law in 2008. Mm. And really, when we started to make this film, we were just fascinated by him as a character, right? And we really didn't set out to make a film about the militarization of police. But as we moved along in the storytelling process, you know, we found that focusing on one character, on one person, and letting kind of the policy emerge through him was much more efficient and compelling than say beating people over the head with policy and with agenda and with all kinds of different issues that filmmakers might bring to the table. And so I think for me, I found that kind of storytelling is really valuable and maybe even more effective than say, I don't know, an agenda approach to filmmaking, though that certainly has its value as well. Mm.
One thing that's so interesting to me, we've been up here for just a few minutes, and every one of you, when answering your questions, kept repeatedly using the word character, character, characters, talking about characters and stories. And I've loved literature my whole life. I even mentioned my opening remarks. I still pull down my old books I'd have to read in high school English. And I've always loved stories. And what I was always taught is that it's about the characters, and that you have to create characters that people will be sympathetic to. And yet, the three of you have an enormous challenge in that you're often telling stories about people For whom it's very difficult to be sympathetic because they've done something wrong and they've hurt somebody else. Now, that doesn't mean that the person is irredeemable or that, you know, we shouldn't do what we can to help them, but they have done something very bad. And I'm wondering, when you tell those stories, how do you make them sympathetic? Scott, what do you think?
I don't know. I mean, what's more interesting? I mean, is a sympathetic, a fully sympathetic character more interesting, or is a fairly complicated character more interesting? And can you be both complicated and sympathetic at the same time? We just went up to Pelican Bay State Prison, which is the what you would say is where we house the worst of the worst in the largest prison system in the world, California. Solitary confinement, men have been in there for decades. And the label worst of the worst is always tagged to that place. Well, I went up there to meet with 112 guys in solitary confinement who qualified for this new legislation, committed their crimes as children, and they have to get through the parole board. They have to prove that they've changed. And I went and we had cages lined up. You can't even see them face to face. You have to see them through a cage with a bunch of holes. And when I told, one of the first people I talked to was a 63-year-old man who had been in prison for 40 years for a crime that he committed when he was very young. And he had been in solitary confinement, had not touched a human being in 32 years. And when I told him, there's this new law and you're affected by it, and if you can prove to the parole board that you are a changed person, that you're no longer a danger to society, you have the chance of coming home to your family. And this old man in a cage that looked like my grandfather started weeping. And he could not believe what I just told him because he thought he was never going to get out. And he took his pinky finger and he stuck it through the little hole in the cage. And I shook his pinky finger and he said, you're the first person I've touched in 32 years. And so you go up with this perception of you're going to see the worst of the worst. He was in there because he was an associate of a prison gang 32 years before. Associate, not a member, an associate. And he's been in the SHU, the security housing unit, for 32 years. And so obviously you have a unsympathetic character if you look at it at the surface, worst of the worst. And there's some guys in there that are really bad that should be there, don't get me wrong. But as you get into and you explore human beings, you find complications and you find depth and you find lightness in some of the craziest places. So I think a character like that is a far more interesting character than someone who walks in and has no problems and no struggle and no complications the entire time.
That's interesting. It's an interesting character for the audience and for the people who are going to see the movie, but what about, there's also an element in which you want policymakers to kind of respond and you want to move them. Do policymakers want to see a fully sympathetic character or a complicated character?
Well, our strategy on the policy front's a little different. when we go up to pass this legislation, we look at I run a nonprofit and founded a nonprofit called the Anti-Recidivism Coalition, and it is 238 formerly incarcerated men, women, boys, and girls who have signed a commitment when they get released to become a member, to be crime-free, gang-free, drug-free, in school and working, and willing to be of service. So within our coalition, we have a radiologist and a cardiologist who are gang members, went to prison, went to college, went to med school, and now they're saving lives, to construction workers mm-hmm. and engineers. And when we go to Sacramento or to Washington, D.C., I go in every time with six formerly incarcerated folks around me, coat and tie, and we sit down with legislators. And I prefer to sit down with Republicans and moderate Democrats who have never been with us on these issues ever. Mm-hmm. They've never seen it up close and personal. They've never gone into a prison. Mm-hmm. They don't know that redemption is real.
Yeah.
And when you sit six people, some who might have spent 25 years in prison and committed murder, and some who might have done 2 years as a juvenile and they're 21 years old and they're in college, and they say, this is who I was when I was a teenager, this is how I changed my life, and this is what I'm doing now. I'm giving back. I'm paying taxes. I'm raising my kids to never go into the system. I'm raising my kids to go to college. and they see the ripple effect of that positive change, of those success stories. We had the most evangelical, the most far-right person in our entire legislature vote yes on this last bill. Mm. And she's with us forever because of these positive stories. So I really think getting out those success stories and putting them front and center, because if you turn on the news every night, those are not the stories you're hearing. You're hearing about this murder, this shooting, et cetera. So I really think the really good stories need to, we need to figure out a way to get those out there in a real major way.
What do you think, Daniel? Sympathetic characters, complicated characters? Is it different depending on the audience you're trying to reach?
No, I think, firstly, why are you making a certain film? Why are you choosing that script, or why are you choosing that subject to follow? And I think a film that is, and then there's different audiences. You can make a film which is to preach to the choir, or you can make a film which is to take a subject to a much wider audience than before. And the films that preach the choir are more often filled with statistics and data and the one-dimensional sympathetic characters. And those films, I feel, don't move the discussion any way beyond the people who already agree with the perspective of the filmmaker. Then there's a good story, which is a multifaceted, multidimensional character who's complicated. And I've genuinely found in amongst all audiences, policymakers have emotions just like everyone else, apparently, and they can be moved by a film which shows a character for what he is. If the story is well told, I think it can become good dinner party conversation, or it can lead to policy change. Mm. But I think if a story is well told with a complicated character, it can draw everyone in. It's then up to the NGOs who want to rally around a film, or the filmmaker, him or herself, to lead the film into a certain direction. But the film itself, if it can be led by story and by a multidimensional character, it's going to take everyone, I think, a lot further. And I mean, we've done films on subjects from whistleblowers to Texas education, and the choice of character has been everything. Mm-hmm. And the choice of that, showing them in a complicated and nuanced way, has, I believe, what has led us to be able to show those films equally to Republican audiences, to progressive audiences, and for them to meet on certain issues. Mm-hmm. And that's the key. I think the broader the character, the more multidimensional the character, the better the story is going to be.
Scott, I saw you nodding your head a lot. Did you want to comment?
Yeah. No, these gentlemen are very intelligent. It's an honor to be on the same panel with you guys. You know, this is the first feature documentary I've ever made, so it's really nice to hear what they have to say. And I can obviously speak from my own experience in making this one feature documentary. Our main character, I felt like, really embodied what you were talking about, right? In that he started this SWAT team in the 70s, and then, you know, since that time left law enforcement, and then that SWAT team killed his son-in-law. So he's now kind of this big voice for police reform, and he's got this very complicated background, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that people gravitated towards him because he's a voice that can speak to police. He's also a voice that can speak to victims. Mm-hmm. Someone who knows both worlds. He's here somewhere. Dub, where are you at, man? This guy with the hat.
Yeah.
Yeah. And they also told us to shamelessly plug the film. It's playing tonight at 5:30 for all conference goers. So feel free to watch. Anyway, I think in addition to Dub, you know, in our film we have police officers who, you know, it's really easy to villainize any police officer in the United States, and we didn't want to do that. I came from a background of law enforcement where my grandfather was in the FBI for 25 years.
Yeah.
Really had great respect for what law enforcement officers do, just like Dub, who is a former sheriff. And so in cases where officers had been traditionally burned by journalists, we made sure to give them a voice, to try to, as much as possible, empathize and put the audience in their shoes so that they could then know what it's like to be, you know, to be on a raid, you know, when you're called upon to do that.
Yeah.
And I think that, you know, across the country, as we've shown the film, I think police officers have been really receptive to it because of that, you know, because we tried to empathize with both, you know, so-called victims as well as citizens involved in SWAT raids.
I think it's really interesting that you make documentary films. At some point in your life, you decide you had to make a decision. You could make documentaries or you could make non-documentary style films. I'm wondering what you think resonates better with audiences. I mean, I guess I could see the argument both ways. You might argue, well, if it's a documentary, people say, my gosh, this actually happened. But you could also argue, if you tell a story, you can communicate certain truths that, you know, what happened in real life can't be fully communicated. What do you think? What's better?
Well, I'm sure these gentlemen know a lot more than I do, but I would say, you know, I come from a background of documentary film. I think the power in documentary film is that they're of course human stories and people maybe can relate to them, but they're just not as widely seen.
Yeah.
Right? It's harder to get people out to, you know, our film's been in theaters all over the US, but it's hard to get people out to see a documentary, right? They'd rather see The Martian, they'd rather see something else that's entertaining. And so certainly fiction filmmaking has that power, right? If you can attract a broader audience with the same issues, then there's something to be said about that.
We could have Will Smith play him.
It's funny, we've had television buyers and people approach us, and that's kind of in the works right now. But yeah, I think it would reach more people maybe if that's done.
I mean, go on.
No. Scott, you were going to say something. What was the? I don't want to.
I was going to say. I mean, the big problem with documentaries is, and I'm like a fanatic. I mean, I watch tons of documentaries. I think it's the most unbelievable storytelling. I mean, the problem is nobody sees them. I mean, there's no. Let me put it in perspective. We make The Hangover, which does wonders for social justice. Warner Brothers makes the movie. They spend $30 million to make the movie, but they spend $50 million to market the movie. He didn't have $500,000 to market the movie. He probably didn't have $100. $50 million to market The Hangover, which means if you're watching the NBA All-Star Game with the other tens of millions of people watching it, you're going to see five of our ads for The Hangover on there. If you're watching Oprah, because we wanted to get women, it was a wedding movie, and we wanted to get women in the theater, and so the marketing department's like, we're gonna put ads on every Oprah and all this other stuff. And guess what? When the movie opened, 50% of the people that walked in the theater were women on opening night. They spent $50 million. Now, imagine if these two incredible films that are telling the stories that actually affect the issue in this room. Imagine if these films had $50 million to get people to the theaters. Imagine if these films had Brad Pitt or Robert Downey Jr. or Will Smith or Denzel Washington to get people to the theaters. The problem is, I mean, I would say from a storytelling point of view, I would say documentary every day over some made-up story starring a movie star. Mm-hmm. But in terms of really changing the narrative, in terms of really showing nuanced characters and more than what people see on the news, the darkness and the awful stories that they see on the news every night, if we really are going to get people to change their perspectives, the ones who are voting for our legislators, the ones that are sitting on our juries, if we're going to get those people in society to change their perspectives, then there needs to be a major investment in not just making the art and the incredible art that these guys made, and I've seen his movie and it's unbelievable and I can't wait to see yours, that we need to also put the money behind it to get it out there and make sure the public sees it.
I actually have a slightly different perspective. I mean, when people say to me, what are you looking for in a documentary? My perpetual answer is, I want it to play like fiction. Because I think a good story is a good story, and Hollywood knows how to tell good stories, and that is a good basis for a documentary, how yours is told, how we like to tell our films. And in fact, with The Mind of Mark DeVries, we're actually working on a fiction remake now, because that will bring the issue to a wider audience. But I agree, budget is where a lot of it comes down to. And there's one thing, adding more budget to documentary marketing, but I think another important aspect is the marketing to scriptwriters and to studio executives in Hollywood. And I know there's lots of companies from animal ethics to stop prison rape, working to advocate for the inclusion of their issues on TV shows and in films. And I think if we can incorporate the right issues and characters that represent the policy reform we're looking for in TV shows, in big Hollywood films, then that's where the difference can really be, because then the millions or the hundreds of millions of homes will be reached and the issues will be included them. And you do begin to see that when you watch the cop shows, CSI and things like that. More and more we're beginning to see certain issues being treated intelligently. And they might be maybe minor plot lines, but they're slowly infiltrating into that production. I think that's a really good step forward.
Daniel, could you talk a bit about your film that Scott just praised? I want the audience to also know about it too.
Yeah, so The Mind of Mark DeVriest, Gabe London, the director, has been making it for 14, 15 years. Story of a guy, and he committed a very minor crime. He took his father's tools after his father had died, before the will was probated, and his evil stepmom reported him to the police, and they picked him up and would have let him go immediately, but he ran away. And because he ran away, his sentence grew. And this was back in Florida in the 70s, and he kept escaping. He was known for a period of time as the Houdini of Florida. He had some national infamy in the late 70s, early 80s, and ended up with a sentence, what started as this minor crime, and for never having committed a violent crime, a sentence that was until 2085, including 34 years in solitary. I believe he's spent the longest amount of time in solitary of any American, but that's, you guys probably know if that's true or not. That might be on marketing. But it was a long time it affected, and he clearly had a mental illness which was never treated and didn't know how to work within the prison system. There was one minority opinion that by a psychiatrist that said he was faking mental illness when he first went to prison. And 30 years later, that psychiatrist came back and met the director, Gabe, and said, if I knew then what I know now, that was my first case on the job, that guy would never have seen the inside of a prison. And so the psychiatrist himself went about his own journey to try and put together a case for the parole board to have Mark paroled. Unfortunately, the first cut of the film, which premiered at the Los Angeles Film Festival last year, 2014, was a sad ending. The parole board rejected the plea, even though he'd shown a complete reduction of disciplinary record, he had a zero disciplinary record, et cetera, et cetera. The film then came out, and it's all, his background, the escapes are shown in animation, in very graphic, sort of graphic comic style animation, so it's very dramatic, and then we have access to him in prison, then all his team, his wife, his lawyer. The film came out with somewhat of a sad ending. Gabe, the director, then used the film to show it to the parole board and show it to key audiences in Florida. And at his parole hearing last November, after the key people had seen the film, they reduced his sentence by 70 years. We then had this wonderful opportunity between the film premiering and the film broadcasting on Showtime to actually change the ending of the film to show what had happened. And that's where the film is now. The film's back out in theaters actually at the moment. But he's still serving a four-year non-parolable sentence, and so we're still trying to get that cut. He's in California serving out those last 4 years. But it's been a mammoth journey for him. The film, being involved with the film, has given him hope, it's given his wife hope, and it's caused a coalition of people and organizations around us, which we hope, after hopefully releasing Mark, will actually extend to greater policy reform.
I wanted you to talk about your movie, and Scott, you talked about Peace Officer, which I'm happy about, but Scott Budnick, why don't you talk a bit about your new film project, Good Films?
Yeah, I mean, I got incredibly concerned with the lack of a meaningful way to get these stories out. So I kind of used my success with the Hangover films, and by the way, I made 11 comedies, and then I left for 2 years to start the Anti-Recidivism Coalition. But then I realized, after sitting through some jury trials and talking to legislators about their constituents, that the largest problem I believe we have is a narrative problem, which is a storytelling problem. And so using my expertise and my success on the Hangover, I partnered with the guy who's the largest finance guy in Hollywood, who's raised $200 billion for the entertainment business, to start a film company solely around these issues, to tell stories both narratively in terms of feature films, television, documentaries, digital content, and it's going to be a $300 million film fund around these stories. So we have celebrity partners, John Legend, Robert Downey, Brad Pitt, Tobey Maguire, who will be our celebrity partners and investors, and they'll be actually producing the content. We looked for and spoke to a lot of celebrities who actually put their time and their heart and their money into their passions and their causes. So they are going to be partners in good films, and as well as a lot of charitable foundations. And the idea is to find incredible art, to put a lot of marketing support behind that art, as well as creating and hiring writers and writing the kind of stories. Brad Pitt's company gave me a script, and the studio asked us if we'd be their first, it would be our first investment, on a movie about the LA riots, a period piece. But this story was about a father who is on parole and comes home from prison a completely and totally changed man and wants to make sure his child doesn't go down the same path he went down. The LA riots kick off. His child goes into the riots, and the story is about a father, a hero, a changed man on parole, going into the hearts of the LA riots to save his son's life. And to me, having a hero in a film who will probably be depicted by a movie star, who is formerly incarcerated, who committed a violent crime, who changed his life, who transformed, and is now the hero you're gonna watch for an hour and a half, that's a film I believe $50 million in marketing funds need to be behind. Good Films is gonna be created in partnership with these celebrities, in partnership with a lot of foundations and some individuals and some endowments to lift up these stories and make sure that millions of people see the incredible art that these guys are making.
I wonder if you guys think that there are different stories that resonate differently with different political audiences. Do liberals like one kind of story, and conservatives like one kind of story, and libertarians like one kind of story? Dan, you're laughing. What do you think?
Well, we did a film called The Revisioners, which did won a lot of awards, DuPont's, and finally was on PBS as well.
Yeah.
And it was about the Texas Board, very, very briefly, about the Texas Board of Education, uh-huh. which determines where textbooks are, how they're written for the whole country, because it's the largest order of textbooks in the country.
Yeah.
And our lead character was a creationist, which for a documentary filmmaker, which is a traditionally progressive forum, it was very strange to have a sympathetic lead character as a creationist.
Yeah.
But what that enabled us to do, because he was told honestly, he was a lovable character. He also dug his own grave in many ways. But he was a very lovable character who was very supportive of the film. And that enabled us to go into his audiences with him and also to progressive audiences. Because I think, you know, I don't like to use the word truth because I think there isn't one truth. But if you are honest and authentic to your characters and your characters are honest with and your characters are honest with you, then that film can reach out to everybody.
Mm.
I must say, though, that I do believe that progressives seem to be more open to the data-driven preach-to-the-choir films.
Mm-hmm.
And what documentary filmmakers particularly who tend to make for the left and right coasts forget is that the heartland is the biggest audience.
Yeah.
There's a very hungry audience, a super intelligent audience, and I think a film that is more open to good storytelling.
Scott, you live in the heartland. You live in my favorite city, Austin, Texas. Is there a way to make movies that appeal to people in the middle of the country rather than on the coasts?
Well, I just moved to Utah, back to Utah.
that's even more heartland.
Right, you're right. you know, I can, in our own film, many conservatives who have not seen the film have either expressed frustration like, oh, I'm never gonna see this anti-cop movie.
Yeah.
And I'm like, well, have you seen the movie? It's about a cop who started a SWAT team, right? And I think once they see the film, they realize, oh, this kind of issue, this idea can speak to both audiences. That's a challenge, I think, as Daniel pointed out, sometimes both you know, we make films for, you said, both coasts, right, more or less?
And Austin.
And Austin, the Republic of Austin, right? but I think that's kind of the challenge for filmmakers, and I think it is to, how can you appeal to both audiences? How can you appeal to libertarians, to progressives, to conservatives? And I think we found that you can't please everybody, but at the same time, you can try to, you know, have empathy for all those involved in this very complicated, heavy, very complex issue. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the way that you do that, you know, I like to talk about Al Maisels, who's this very famous documentary filmmaker that just passed away. He's kind of one of the pioneers of doc filmmaking. And he said, you know, you have to love your subjects. You have to love those who are in your film and empathize with them and show empathy for them. And I think that for me as a filmmaker, creating a documentary meant a lot. And I use that as kind of a mantra in talking to victims or people who are on the receiving end of SWAT raids, as well as police officers who have to put their lives on the line, and that's their job, right? Yeah. And I think, you know, we, places like Madison, Wisconsin, or even small communities in Wisconsin have been, you know, like traditionally conservative communities, like sheriffs have loved the film because they felt like their voice was out there, right? That they were being heard. Though I must say that some of the police officers in our film, even though we felt like we represented them well, they were pissed off, right? They were a couple of them were mad at me, and understandably so. You know, we were kind of picking apart their worst night. Anyway. My long-winded answer, sorry.
No, not at all. Scott, did you want to comment?
I think I'd like to comment more from the policy perspective. I think the telling of the success stories of folks that have come out of prison and those that have kind of pulled themselves up by their bootstraps is something that I've seen work across the board. Mm-hmm. We had a kid named Prophet Walker, who was one of my students in juvenile hall, who went to prison for his first offense ever, which was getting into a fight on a train and fracturing someone's jaw. And he went to prison for 6 years. He was 16 at the time of the crime. And in prison, earned his two-year AA degree, applied to the Loyola Marymount School of Science and Engineering from prison, and got his acceptance letter in his prison dorm, and left. Went to the Loyola Marymount School of Science and Engineering, graduated, and 2 weeks after getting out of prison, he came to me and was just frantic, needing a job because he had a little daughter that he had before he went to prison. And he went to a backyard kind of fundraiser, met a guy who ran an architectural engineering firm, and like a month out of prison, he was making $110 an hour building a hospital in Santa Monica. And this is obviously an extreme success story, but when he came to Sacramento and talked to legislators, they went so crazy for him that night they all asked him for dinner. So he's at dinner with four Republicans and two Democrats who've never dined with each other ever, but they all want to dine with Prophet Walker. So they're at dinner at the Chop Steakhouse across from the Capitol because they were so moved by this story. And when you take these personal stories and you can show legislators that a yes vote is the right thing to do, the story will get them to say to themselves, you know what, this is the right thing to do. But then you have the other side, which is the political consequences, right? But can I do this? Will I be safe in my district? Will someone use it for a hit piece to take me out, et cetera? The data, you combine the personal stories with the data that they're doing the right thing, that crime is not gonna go up, that this is the right public safety decision as well. And you combine those two things, then you're bulletproof. And that's what we've really seen work well in California.
We're going to move to audience Q&A, and there's a microphone set up in the middle there. People can come up and ask questions. As they do that, I'll just note that Scott mentioned these students that he teaches in juvenile hall. I had the great honor of getting to sit in on one of those courses this summer. It was really one of the most amazing things I've ever seen. You know, you had these kids look at a hip-hop song. They looked at the lyrics the way that all of us would have studied Yeats or Keats or something when we were in high school, because it's going to be harder for them to want to do that. But these hip-hop songs are modern poetry, and one by one they were going through the lines and talking about what the lines made them feel, and they talked about their experiences, and it was really a very remarkable morning. I enjoyed it very much. First question.
Hi, Eric Samuelson, Family Restoration Network. We're on the reentry side. I could, we meet guys in the jail, walk with them as they get out, looking for fathers of minor children. That's our subset. We could really use your films, your work. There's some just goofy things out there that would not tell the story anywhere near as effectively as what you've done. So I would ask the Institute perhaps to let us know how to access these works and others. Maybe there's a library of high quality stuff, a list, yeah, exactly. So I think that would be a huge benefit to guys like us that are at the practitioner level.
We'll do that, absolutely.
Okay, yeah. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay. Kirsten Tynan with the Fully Informed Jury Association. I'm probably one of the few people on the planet who is really excited by jury duty and is very inspired by jurors and the power that they have to save lives. And so I struggle with how to convey that to people who, the instant they hear the term jury duty, they want to run the other way. And I was wondering if you have any thoughts on what kinds of stories or how to approach storytelling to, you know, convey the importance of the power of the jury. Should I be talking about people whose lives were saved by jurors, people whose lives could have been saved but weren't by jurors? Should I be talking about jurors themselves? What are your suggestions on that?
I mean, kind of, as a producer's perspective, my only point to you would be the following, is it's incredibly hard to get access. The best story is one that's told, documentary-wise, is one that's told in real time. Really allows you to get to know the characters rather than a retrospective. And getting access in real time to courts and to juries and jury selection is near impossible. If, through your organization, there would be any chance to get that access so that a camera could actually follow the process around a particular trial, a particular selection, or something around that, I think a remarkable film can and should be done. I agree with you. I think it gets such bad press, jury duty, yet it's such an important civic duty. And I think if the access could be gained, and if you get that, you know, I'd be very happy to put you in contact with filmmakers who could go with you along that journey and put that up on the screen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, J.S.B. Morse, author. Charles Koch was recently quoted as saying that he and his brother were largely failures at changing America. And I'm wondering if that is because there's too much of a stress on getting the right people elected in politics, and maybe even too much stress on changing the actual legislation, as opposed to changing culture and using film, particularly, you might have a opinion about that, to change the culture. Maybe, Scott, you could have an idea about that. I'm excited to hear about good films.
Are you suggesting that the Kochs invest in good films?
I don't. You probably wouldn't argue with that, right?
That's the second time
where's
that's
the
happened
where's
at this
the
summit.
Yeah, what do you think about the balance between those two efforts?
I think they're just beautifully complementary. I think, I mean, I've realized that kind of the three big boxes here, if we want to see a safer society and healed people, is our politics, which obviously dictates how much money are going towards certain services and how much aren't. How many people we're putting in prison and who we aren't. So I think the political piece is enormous. I think the storytelling culture piece is important. I just got to take John Legend to a California prison, and he, as you've seen, he's done a national tour going to different prisons, and I think having someone with his pedigree as a musician doing this, I think is huge on the culture front. And I think we need to keep doing these sort of things. And there's also the reentry piece, which is just so insanely crucial. We could pass all the greatest laws to reduce the prison population and send people home who are no longer dangerous, but if we don't have the support for them when they get home, this might actually just come back to bite us in the butt. So those supports are huge. I think housing is huge. Putting someone in a very stable, supportive environment to grow and flourish when they get home, not send them right back into the dragon's lair of dysfunction. So I think all three things, when working side by side and having equal investment, will produce results that show us all on the right side of history.
Another question.
I'm Shannon with Partnership for Safety and Justice, and we're an organization that works on criminal justice reform from the perspective of both people convicted of crime and also victims of crime. And oftentimes victims have suffered the same kinds of neglect as people who get arrested for crimes, right? Whether it's housing or all kinds of things. And I'm wondering if you all have thought about telling the story of victims as we're holding up and lifting up this narrative around criminal justice reform.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Well, I mean, it's a great question. I mean, I feel there are a lot of films about victims of crime. I don't think there can ever be enough because it's important stories to tell. One of the challenges that often comes up when you're trying to sell, particularly a documentary film, is that the gatekeepers, the buyers, the distributors are looking for balance. And there's always this question of, well, you've shown the victim, what about the other side? Or you've shown the perpetrator, what about the other side? And storytelling, and particularly access, doesn't always work like that. But yes, there's no reason at all why, you know, victims, I do feel that actually the victims get a good play on screen.
Scott, you looked like you wanted to comment.
Yeah, I was gonna say, there's sometimes a myth about documentary film too that it's objective somehow, but the reality is that objectivity doesn't exist, right? It's really the subjective representation of the filmmaker. I think if you can strike a balance, though, that at least gives an impression of objectivity or give a voice to both victims we found in our film that really those on the receiving end of the SWAT raids as well as police, both of them are victims, right? And that's often the case, is that, you know, there's this systemic problem with policy that exists that's forcing police officers to unnecessarily put their lives on the line, right? And so I think, you know, it depends on how you define victim and what victims, when you say victims, right? You know, I think if we can somehow find a way as filmmakers to give both a voice, yeah, that's...
Well, I think that's exactly right. In the criminal justice system here, so often both sides are victims to different issues.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, the question when you're telling a story is something has to happen. So the question is always, when you're looking at the story of a victim, what does the victim do post-crime? Mm-hmm. And is there an active path? Because that's, you know, for good or for bad, that's what leads to the storytelling.
Yeah, let's move to our next question, because we've got limited time.
Hi, Jasmina Hauser from Justice Fellowship, which is the public policy advocacy arm of Prison Fellowship Ministry, started by Chuck Colson. She hit basically one of my two questions, and that was, what is the role in your films, in your storytelling of the victim? Because restorative justice is Justice Fellowship's to restore the offender, the person who is the victim of the crime, and then the community. So again, with 60 to 90 minutes that you have for a film, can you include both the offender as well as the victim's role? And then the second question is, for you, I think you're in Hollywood, I'm not sure. Part of it is having that interchange of to restore the person inside, and faith has a lot of part to do with that. Do you shy away from telling that part of the story? How a lot of the panelists here during the 3-day conference had talked about how the job's not enough. You got to restore the character of the person who committed the crime. So what roles in your storytelling do you shy away from? Do you actually go after regarding victim, faith, and victim?
That's interesting. Scott, you are in godless Hollywood. How do you guys incorporate it, or do you?
I obviously, we weren't thinking much of that when we made The Hangover. So I wasn't, when I was in Hollywood, wasn't making films that were quite conducive. But definitely moving forward with good films. I think the role of and the stories of victims and faith will definitely play huge roles in the stories we tell, enormous roles. I mean, I know firsthand these films can be very profitable as well as move the needle on narrative change, and I know it because I don't remember if it was the first week or the second week, but The Hangover, which was the opposite of what I'm about to say, which was the highest grossing R-rated comedy of all time, was completely and totally crushed by Passion of the Christ. That film, I think, may be one of the highest grossing films ever made. And whether you are going for, like, intentionally and in your marketing, going for a faith-based audience, or making a film where faith has a real undercurrent, but you're not marketing it in that way, I think either way is the right way to go. I think you have to look at the story first, and then what outcomes do you want to achieve, and then figure out what the best route to go there is. But I think, obviously, I think American audiences and worldwide audiences love movies that inspire and uplift and strive for you to become the best human being that you can be. And so I think faith plays an enormous role. Thank you.
One more question, final question of the day.
Thank you. I'm Chris from Dallas, Texas, and I'm like you guys, I agree that there's nothing more powerful than a story to stir a heart and get an outcome. But my question for y'all, because you're the only people that I know who have actually successfully gone into a prison to film, and I've been working on a film and trying to get access, and Texas Department of Criminal Justice does not agree with me in the power of a story. So I'm wondering how you navigated that and were able to get in, because I've been given an hour to get in and do this, but it's a complex issue. So how do you have any advice?
We're actually just finishing a film in Texas, which got us inside a prison considerably, about the San Antonio Four. For those of you that know that case, I know Scott knows the case. I'd be very happy to talk to you about it. I don't think it's a public discussion, but there are certainly ways in which include careful advocacy, a lot of diplomacy, meeting the right departments, and going in with the right allies and advocates.
Okay.
Very happy
Thank you.
To discuss with you.
And I'm just going to make one more brief announcement. This is Brianna Walden with the Charles Koch Institute. One film that we are supporting and promoting tonight is Peace Officer, which has been mentioned. I have tickets, so if you're going to be around or you know people who live in the area, we have purchased a block of tickets and would love to distribute those. There will be brief Q&A with Scott and Dub, who was pointed out earlier, and William Ruger, our Senior Vice President of Research at the Charles Koch Institute.
And Dub's way more interesting than I am.
Well, we've reached the conclusion of this panel, so please join me in thanking our three panelists. Well, we've also reached the conclusion of the summit, and I'm not going to give long-winded closing remarks because I know that people have planes to catch and things like that, but I want to answer the one question that everybody keeps asking me, and that is, are you going to do this again? And the answer to that question is, I don't know. And the reason it's I don't know is we have to see what comes of this, and we have to see what comes of the interactions that we've had from all of you. You need to communicate with us, whether that's talking to us directly, whether or not that's putting things in the suggestion box, whether or not that's using the app that we put together on the Advancing Justice app, telling us, you know, what you thought went well, what you think could happen in the future, what you think are the next steps. That's the most important thing. What comes out of this, and whether it's going to be legislation, whether it's storytelling, whether it's research and data and doing more with the university community. You guys just got to let us know. And if we see actual tangible change coming from this conference, then yeah, I think there's a chance we would do it again. But it's really all about all of you and what happens next. Thank you so much for attending these 3 days. I really, really appreciated it. No, come on. Thank you so much for coming to this.